डूइंग इट, बेस्ड ऑन सम सिमिलरिटी मेजर, बेस्ड ऑन सम सिमिलरिटी मेजर दैट विल ट्राई टू ग्रुप देम इनटू डिफरेंट ग्रुप्स. यू कैन ट्राई टू सी दी थ्री लुक समवॉट सिमिलर, राइट? दी थ्री पैटर्न्स लुक समवॉट सिमिलर एंड दीज फाइव डिजिट पैटर्न्स लुक सिमिलर, राइट? सी ऑल ऑफ देम आर वंस ओनली, ऑल ऑफ देम आर डिजिट वंस ओनली, बट बेस्ड ऑन सिमिलरिटी वी आर ट्राइंग टू ग्रुप दिस इनटू कैटेगरीज. सी ग्रुप वन, दिस इज ग्रुप टू, बट देयर इज नो लेबल असाइंड. हियर वी असाइंड अ लेबल ऑफ ए, राइट? हियर वी असाइंड अ लेबल ऑफ बी फॉर दिस. हियर वी आर नॉट असाइनिंग लेबल ऑफ वन, लेबल ऑफ वन फॉर दिस. वी आर नॉट असाइनिंग दैट वन बिकॉज दैट इज अननोन. क्लस्टरिंग एग्जाम्पल रेस्पॉन्स टू अननोन कैटेगरीज आर अननोन क्लासेस. क्लासिफिकेशन एग्जाम्पल रेस्पॉन्स टू नोन कैटेगरीज. It means the task of classifier is you give some input to your system that should try to assign some label or some class name to that one. That's the target of classification. For example, if I show you some dog picture, you should try to give the label like this is a dog. And if I show you some cat picture, if your system is trying to label it like a cat picture, then you can call it like classification. Clustering example is like this. Suppose if a kid saw a bunch of sheep, at least he may not know whether that is sheep or not, that 2 year kid, but at least he can able to say that all are falling under same category. He don't know that name of that one is sheep, but he can guess that all of them are under same category. Based on some similarity, right? They look similar. Those are all sheep. But he don't know that label. That's called as clustering. Based on some similarity measure, you try to cluster into different groups. Okay, next. What is a pattern? A pattern could be an object or an event typically represented by a vector of numbers. For example, consider these signals. They are the input signals. Can someone tell whether this is 1D or 2D signal? This one. He studied signals and systems course and DSP course, right? Can you just tell me what is this signal? Is it 1D or 2D or 3D? See, just consider fingerprint image. See, this is an image, right? This will have spatial coordinates. This is X coordinate, this is Y coordinate, and these are the concerned intensities at a different spatial locations. It's a two dimension. This is also two dimension image, right? This is also two dimension. This is also two dimension. And this is also two dimension. Then what about this? Is it 2D or 1D? For example, consider you are recording an audio file. Is it 1D signal or 2D signal? Audio signal. Is it 1D or 2D audio signal? Can answer, right? Time versus amplitude. You are trying to store these samples in the memory. After following that sampling theorem, then is it 1D or 2D? It's just a function of time, right? Amplitude is a function of time. The function of time is 1D, right? It's a 1D signal. Image corresponds to 2D signal. You are trying to store these pixels in the memory. For example, this is 4 by 4 image. You will try to store 16 pixels in the memory. It's a 2D, right? Image is a 2D. X coordinate is a Y coordinate. The 2D signal. What about video? Is it 1D or 2D or 3D? He can speak, right? What about video? Is it 1D, 2D or 3D video signal? Okay, 3D, right? Okay, that's fine. Why that is 3D? Is there any reason? That's how, that's function of time and space, right? Video is nothing but sequence of images. Image is a 2D, that is in 2D space, right? XY coordinates, function of XY coordinates, that intensity as a function of XY coordinates. And across time also that images will vary, right? There is change of images. It's function of time and XY coordinates. So you can call it like 3D, three-dimensional, that video. And this corresponds to image. You can call this like a 2D, function of XY coordinates, this pattern. These are some of the patterns. These are the biometric patterns. Fingerprint, the iris. This is called as iris, I-R-I-S, iris patterns. And this corresponds to speech pattern and this is face recognition system, right? This is for face recognition system. And this is gesture, right? Hand gestures. And this is a sign. Hand gesture patterns. One more pattern example is hand gestures. For example, here what he is doing is he trying to move both the hands from this side to this side. Hand weaving. He's shaking the hand up and down like this. Similarly, this also. This corresponds to one pattern, right? And in this case, he trying to move his hand in a circle manner like this. That's what he's doing. This is one pattern. Each pattern corresponds to some sign or some signal, right? Like that you can think. And here what he is doing is, he's moving his hand from this point to this point. This is one pattern. And one more pattern is, he's shaking the hand like this. Like bye-bye, right? It's some sign kind of thing. This will contain some information. There are some patterns generated by hand movements. Your system should try to identify those patterns. What are those patterns correspond to? For example, if we do like this, it means like bye-bye kind of thing, right? That should show something like that one. And here he might be showing some direction, right? What is a class? Class corresponds to collection of similar objects. For example, consider all are females in this one. And all these pictures corresponds to male in this male category and female category. There are two different classes, female class and male class. Similarly, you can have dogs category, cats category, goats like this. You can have different categories. Collection of similar objects. And main objective of our classification task is we need to separate the data belonging to different classes and given new data, you should try to assign them to the correct category. U means the system or that particular algorithm should try to assign correct category or correct label. Fine. For example, consider gender classification. X bar is the input vector pattern, and omega corresponds to class label. Here, let's have some terminologies. We are trying to call X bar as the input pattern. For example, if that is my speech signal means you are having some samples, right? Time versus samples. It's a voltage amplitude values, right? This corresponds to your speech signal, speech samples. These sample values you are trying to arrange in a vector form, x1, x2, and so on, x, d. For example, d dimensional vector, so d cross 1. This corresponds to input pattern. You are arranging them, these values, the amplitude values, in a vector form, the d cross 1 vector. Similarly, when coming to images, for example, grayscale image, that black and white image, you will try to, one way is you can try to arrange these pixel intensities in the array format. For example, try to arrange these intensity values in a column. After that, try to arrange this in a column. And after that, try to arrange these pixel values in a column like this. For example, this is 10 cross 10. First, you'll try to note down the values of these intensities, 10 values. After that, you'll try to note down these 10 values and you'll try to arrange like this, 10 values like this, and so on. Then, what is the dimension of this array? Yeah, what is the dimension of this array? You can speak out. How many values you are having in this? You are trying to arrange them in a vector form. Then what is the dimension of this?
100 cross 1, sir.
This is 100 cross 1, right? Here, this is d cross 1, where d corresponds to 100 in this. You can try to say, it's a pattern. It's an input pattern. That's what you are calling. This one way. There are some other ways. You'll try to do some processing over this one. After doing processing, you can try to make it like some 10 cross 1 like that. You'll try to compress this one. For example, if that is a facial image, face image, no need to store each and every pixel. Some of you said on the first day, right? You can try to extract the features like what the eye color. For example, eye color can be X1. It's eye color. And value x2 corresponds to that width of the nose. And value x3 corresponds to distance between two eyes, two eyebrows, like that. There are several parameters. You can try to extract like 10 cross 1, for example. You can try to extract only useful features in that one. You need to go for feature extraction. Instead of blindly storing pixel by pixel like an array, you can go for this one, so that you can reduce the computations, right? Once you got small dimensional pattern, you can try to manipulate this effectively. That's why you'll try to go for this kind of compression. X bar corresponds to such patterns. X bar corresponds to such patterns. And omega is a class label. We are trying to depend omega notation for class label. For example, omega 1 corresponds to class A. This is just an example. Omega 2 corresponds to class B. And so on. Omega 26 corresponds to class Z. It's a notation we are following. Instead of using these labels, we are trying to name the classes by this. See class 1, class 2, see class 26. like that we are labeling just for our convenience. That's it. They are the class labels. In this particular example, is a classification of male or female. That's it, right? Male or female. That's what we are doing here. Omega 2 corresponds to male category and omega 1 corresponds to female category. Yeah, what the task of classifier is, first we will try to train that algorithm with the help of known classes. Known classes means, for example, okay, in your class there are 70 students. For example, try to collect 30 male students, 30 female students from your class. 10 left over, right? You will try to train that algorithm with the help of these 30 male and 30 female categories. Okay, what we are doing is, suppose in your class, out of 70 students, for example, 35 belongs to male, 35 belongs to female. What we are going to do is, you will try to divide this into two parts. It's just an example, it's not an exact one. Training data, test data. Just assume that you are having 35 pictures of male, 35 pictures of female images from your class, 35 and 35, total. You will try to have randomly 30 out of 35 male. Out of 35 male images, you will try to pick randomly 30 male images and 30 female images. Randomly, out of the 35, 35. And you can call this like training data or training set. And remaining 5 is there, right? 5 male and 5 female. You can try to call this like test data or test set. With the help of these training data, you will try to train your algorithm. You will try to train your pattern recognition algorithm or that machine learning algorithm with the help of this training data with known labels. It means what you are going to do is, you will try to have some model or some algorithm, ML algorithm or pattern recognition algorithm. This will be there. What you are going to do is, you will try to give some male image from this. Suppose if you got the output like female, input image is male, but output that is showing like female, then what you are going to do is, you will try to tune or you will try to adapt the parameters in this one. There will be some parameters, tuning parameters. Or learning parameters. There will be some learning parameters in your model or in your algorithm. You will try to tune those parameters in order to make it like male. That's what you will try to do. Similarly, you will try to get some female image, input female. If you got the output like female, output label like female, then no need to tune this one. And one more female image you consider from here, and you are giving female input, and suppose if you got male output, then what you are going to do is, you'll try to tune the parameter, because there's an error, right? There's a mistake with this algorithm. You'll try to adapt or you'll try to update the parameters in this. Update your model indirectly. It's a model or an algorithm, machine learning algorithm. If you got some mistake, you'll try to update this one. That's what you are doing. Finally, you'll try to iterate this process, this learning process. You'll try to iterate this learning process until all of them are getting exactly perfect in this one. This one example. You should make sure that if you give any one of the 30 male images, output should be male. If you give any one of these 30 female images, output should be female. If you got that scenario, then your training is done. Almost done. if you successfully able to classify them like male and female perfectly, your training is almost done. This is not done completely, almost done. Your next step is you should try to test with unknown images. These are the unknown images for your algorithm, right? You trained your algorithm with the help of these 60 images. It means your algorithm don't know these 10 images, right? It's unknown for your algorithm. Now, you'll try to give one of them as input to this one. And if you are getting male, then it's fine. This algorithm is working. You'll try for all these 10 images. If this is being correct output, then you can try to say your algorithm can generalize well. Generalization. Your algorithm is able to generalize well because you are training this with the help of some known images, known male faces, known female faces. And after that, you are trying to test with unknown images. These are the unknown categories, right, for your algorithm because you have not trained this with the help of them. Suddenly, if some unknown face came, there should be in a position to categorize that like male or female perfectly. If that's able to categorize, then you can try to say that can do generalization very well. Generalization. That's what we require. For example, if this is giving almost zero error for training set, but all of these are errors, is it good or bad? Yeah, one of you can answer. Suppose your machine learning algorithm or pattern recognition algorithm is perfectly right for this training data. That means after rigorous training, that's able to classify these 30 males like males only, these 30 female faces like female only. That's able to give the output like that. But whenever new data came, some other face other than these faces came, that's trying to give some false output. For male, that is giving female. For female, that's giving male. Then is it good or bad?
Bad.
That's bad, right? That can be good only when it's able to generalize for others also. That should be in a position to generalize, right? If this is giving error for this one, can you call it like by-hatting? Is it same as by-hatting? That is working well. See, working well for training set but not well with test set or test data, then can you call this like by-hatting?
Yes, sir.
It's by-hatting, right? It's just a by-hatting like kind of thing. For example, yeah, if you practice the question like this, okay, that F equal to ma is there, right? Newton's formula. F equal to ma is there. In your class, they mentioned that how to find F if you know M and A. If you know what is M and what is A, you are very well trained in the class. You can simply multiply them. That's what they trained you in the class. But in the exam, suppose they give F and A and they ask you what is that mass. If you are unable to do this one, can you call it like generalization if you are unable to do this? If you are unable to do this one, that won't be generalization. You should be in a position to do that one. That's called like generalization capacity. If you are unable to do this one, you can say you are by-hatting the things. That's what happening here also. That's simply trying to by-hat the training set. What are the training set you are giving? That's simply by-hatting the training set. It's not trying to learn the patterns. This is not trying to learn the patterns from your training set. If that's able to learn the patterns from your training set, then that's able to classify your test set also. Your ultimate goal is your algorithm should try to extract useful patterns and learn those patterns from your training set. That's a target. Instead of learning those patterns, if they're simply by hearting that inputs, then that won't generalize to outsiders. Some new images or test images. That's simply called as by hearting. The terminology for this one is overfitting. Overfitting to training set. Overfitting means you are that algorithm is trying to give the output perfectly for your training set. That's giving exact output, whatever you are expecting for your training set. That's called as overfitting. But it's unable to generalize, right? Overfitting means it's perfect for your training set, but unable to fit your test data. Then this is called as overfitting. Indirectly, what we are expecting is that particular machine learning algorithm or pattern recognition algorithm should try to learn this boundary. It's a decision boundary. This is called a decision boundary. This foundation boundary. For example, if you are this side of the decision boundary, you can try to call that like female. If you are this side of the decision boundary, then you can try to call this like male images. For example, new male picture came. Somewhere here, this is a male picture somewhere here. Then this side of decision boundary, you can categorize that like male. And if you got some female picture somewhere here, you can try to categorize that like female, right? Because that is this side of decision boundary. It means your algorithm learn this pattern or this decision boundary. Learning a decision boundary, right? Indirectly, your algorithm is trying to learn some decision boundary. This should be learned during the training process. You'll try to train your machine learning algorithm or the pattern recognition algorithm with the help of training set with known labels. Known labels means you'll give this as input. This, for example, this is the training set. This is also the training set. You'll give this as input to your machine learning algorithm, and you'll try to inform to that machine that this should be female. It means you are trying to inform this is a female also. You are informing the tag also, right? You are informing along with the tag. Here also, you'll try to give this as input to that learning algorithm. And not only this one, you'll try to inform that machine that this is a male. If that machine got error, then they'll like to update that one. If they didn't get error, then no need to update those weights or parameters, the learning parameters. That means training data corresponds to this data with labels, along with the labels. You should not give only these images. You should say that this is female, 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 female like that for the training set. Similarly, you should say that along with these images, this corresponds to males. But for the testing time, you won't inform your machine that this is male or female. You'll simply give some image and you'll ask that machine, just cross-check whether this is male or female. That will give whether male or female during the test phase. During the training phase, you'll try to give along with label, class label. This is something like you are training your kid. To your kid by showing some dogs and some cats. You simply show that kid like this dog like that for several times, some different dogs. And you'll try to show that kid some cats and you'll simply say to kid like this is a cat like that. That means you are showing the kid that particular dog and you are telling the label also, right? Similarly, you are showing that cat picture or cat to that kid, and you are telling him that label also. The concerned label is cat, like that you are saying. And he will try to extract, indirectly he will try to extract, that kid will try to extract some useful patterns from that cat scenes and the dog scenes. And whenever some new dog or new cat came, he can try to guess, this is a dog or this is a cat, based on this training, right? Earlier he trained with labeled data. Now whenever some new dog came, he should be in a position to generalize. He should say that this is also a dog. It means he trying to extract some useful patterns from the training set. That's what he doing. He not simply byhearting those images, or he not simply byhearting those scenes. He trying to extract some useful patterns and learning those useful patterns from the training set. After that, he trying to generalize to new data. That's what he doing. Same thing we are going to do for our machine learning or pattern recognition algorithm. Exactly same thing. First, you will try to train that learning algorithm with the help of known data. It means with known labels. After that, that should generalize for new data. That's the target of machine learning algorithm. Yeah, let's skip this. Can you guess what is the problem here? Yeah, one of you can answer this. It's clearly visible, right? Some of the key challenges in classification. For classification, there are some challenges. Yeah, one of you can answer. Yeah, you can look into this one. Intra-class variability. Inter-class variability. You can try to observe this carefully and try to give me the answer. Yeah, one of you can answer. What are the issues that you are observing here?
Sir, in this variability, we have T's like in different styles, sir.
Okay.
And in interclass variability, the same numbers are, I mean, those are looking similar, right? So, I think it's getting confused, sir.
Yes, that may get confused, right? This is a problem with that one. Let's explain this. For example, just consider 3 years kid, that LKG or UKG. Yeah, when generally kids will go to LKG? Is 3 years or 5 years? When? Your answer, right? Is it 3 years age or 5 years age? Which one? If you want, you can type, no problem for me.
Four, sir.
Four? Okay, let's consider that. Let's say 4 years age. He went to LKG, for example, and he started learning letters. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and so on. After few months, he's able to recognize all these letters, A to Z. And if you ask him, what is this letter? He can answer without any doubt. He will say F. Try that, he can say. If you ask him, what is this letter? He can say Z. There's no problem at all. That's fine. But if you ask that kid, What is this letter? Can he answer? Or what is this letter? Can you answer?
No, sir.
Why?
The T is also, he thinks that it can be E also.
He learned like this, right?
Yes,
Upper
yes.
case. He learned the upper case only. He learned T like this only. In this format. If there are some variations, he can guess. There's no doubt. Because by default, if you are writing T, you won't write T always like this, right? He will be tuned to that one. He can generalize up to some level. Up to some level, he can generalize the things. For example, first time he wrote T like this, second time he may write like this. Third time he may write like this. He is able to generalize. Might be this bigger. Might be this, might be bigger, like that. In the process of that learning, he can generalize up to this level without any doubt. He'll get this ability in that process of learning. But when he suddenly jumped to this small letter A, this looks completely new for him, right? This completely looks odd for him. He won't recognize this like letter A. That's very difficult for him. If possible, he'll try to guess that this might be O, letter O, or something like that, right? He'll have some doubt like this might be O, something like that. Because he didn't come across this one earlier, right? This is a problem. It's a problem with intra-class variability. Intra-class means within the same class. These two corresponds to same class. Class A only. Letter A only, these two. Within the same class, there is some variability, right? It means you need to teach this one to the kid and you need to teach this also, right? You need to teach uppercase letters and lowercase letters also to that kid. Then only he can generalize, right? And no need to teach the kid about all the variations, all these variations. He can generalize, there's no doubt at all. If you try to teach the kid with some variations, and if someone gave like this, he can generalize this like A without any doubt. But if high variation is there is more variation, right, from this to this, that you need to teach to that kid. Otherwise, he won't learn, right? Similarly, while training your machine learning algorithm, you need to train your algorithm with this one and this data also. You should not train only with this one. You should train with this and this. Then only that can do effectively, right? Otherwise, that may give wrong results. This is intra-class variability. Inter-class variability means what is the difficulty with this? Inter-class means different classes. This corresponds to different classes. And is shown like letter D and letter O. And letter zero is a digit. Letter O is a D. They look almost similar, right? This variation is somewhat less. The child may get confusion, right? At least she may get confusion that whether this is zero or whether this is a O. He'll be in confusion mode, right? It's not so easy. This is also a problem actually. Inter-class variability. For example, I write something like this. Can you just tell me whether this is O or zero? Is it O or zero? Is it O or zero? Can you just tell me this? This is zero, right? What is this? Is
O.
zero or O this one?
O, sir.
This is O, right? This is letter O. This is digit zero. How can you say that?
That is a number and this is a word, sir.
Oh, this number and this one, right? That means after some experience, if you gain some experience with these things, where you are going to use all this knowledge, with the help of that knowledge, you can try to segregate, right? At least. You may not separate this individually. You may not say individually, this is one, this is zero, like that. As a group, you are calling this like a number, and with the help of that knowledge, you can try to decode this like zero, zero, like that. And with your knowledge, you are trying to say that this is some word, and from there, with the help of that knowledge, you want to say this is not zero, this is O. That's what you are doing, right? Yeah, that will come under intelligence. You need to learn something and you need to apply that knowledge somewhere else, right? That's what you are doing here. Artificial intelligence also, that should be somewhat in this manner only. You'll try to train something and that should try to abstract that knowledge, and from that knowledge, that should try to do something else. Something relevant, kind of thing. It's a problem with inter-class variability. It's hard to separate them. It's one way to separate them. If you feel that number, you can try to separate at least these two, right? That knowledge you can apply. That will come under NLP, Natural Language Processing. And some other applications are handwritten recognition. This is called as OCR, Optical Character Recognition System. Handwritten letters, that's converted to printed letters, right? You need to decode each and everything. With the help of machine, this can be done. And biometric recognition system. You have that fingerprint recognition system in your campus, right? Near main gate, you need to put this BAMA, biometric management system, right? Similarly, iris, you might have given this for other, right? For other identification purpose, iris. And this is speech recognition system. For example, some people will give speech identification password, right? For your systems, laptop. That should recognize your voice, whether the same person is speaking or some other person is speaking. Speaker identification with the help of speech, the speech pattern. And this is face recognition system. And this is sign. You want to recognize your sign, whether the same person is signing or someone is signing. The other different classes for fingerprint, some of the classes. Class 1, class 2. You can say omega 1, omega 2, omega 8, our notations, right? You can look into these terminologies. And this is face detection system. You might have seen this in Facebook, right? If you go to Facebook, if you try to upload some images in Facebook, that might try to have this kind of boundaries, right? And you can try to tag the name. For example, if you got the boundaries like this one, and that will let you show, you can tag this person, you can tag this person like that, right? That's automatically detecting your face, faces in that particular image. The face detection. Okay, what is the difference between face detection and face recognition? What is the difference? See, face detection system means suppose there are four pictures in that one. that should try to identify this is the face, this is the face, this is the face, like that. Face recognition system means after detecting this face, that should try to assign the name for that one. Suppose if you are have in your database, student database, there are some images, right? They will try to map to those images. Suppose this is some student number one. Number one, this is student number 20, number 31, number 72, like that. These ID numbers. If you try to assign the concerned ID numbers or labels, this can be name also. There's a face recognition system. Where the detection is different, recognition is different. After detecting your face, you need to assign name for that one. After assigning the name, you can call it like recognition. And autonomous systems, this is a driverless car and this is a drone, right? Without a driver. We require those sensors. I have given assignment, right? Anyhow, this one. The skin cancer detection, breast cancer detection from those X-ray images or some scanned images. This can be done with the help of pattern recognition. And the recommendation system. This also can be done. Alexa. Amazon Alexa. Speech recognition system. Speech recognition system also based on machine learning or pattern recognition only. Yeah, do you have any doubts? You can ask me. See, I'll try to go very briefly only till this NSEM exams. Your SEM2 NSEM exams are there, right? That you do SEM2. I don't want to go in depth. No need to worry about assignments also. Yeah, you won't give the assignments till that date. Okay, do you have any doubts? You can ask, no problem. If you want, you can type, that's also fine.
Sir, about college reopening, any information?
Oh, that, see, that we can't guarantee. Because ours is extreme case. 7,000 hostelers are there, right? In our college. Compared to outside, ours is a bit extreme case. Unless someone opens, we can't guarantee actually. I can't say. But your exam is scheduled on 16th, right? Are you to SEM2 exams?
Yes, sir.
16. Yeah, any doubts? Okay, it's fine.